Good evening, everybody. Welcome back to Ad America TV. Back again with me, Vivi, and I want to welcome all of our audience and members joining us online. I hope you guys are doing well and, of course, staying safe during this pandemic of COVID-19. And for those of you guys who are joining for the very first time, Ad America is the U.S. Embassy American Center here in Jakarta, and our mission is to provide a space for young Indonesians to learn more about the United States. And yes, we're temporarily moved to a solely digital platform. But don't worry, you can still enjoy us from the comfort of your own home. And today, we're going to discuss about ending violence against Indonesian women and girls through strong policies. But before we start the event for tonight, I'm going to break the ice a little bit. I give you guys a question for today's event. And the question is, when did the United States Congress pass the Violence Against Women Act? I repeat the question one more time. When did the United States Congress pass the Violence Against Women Act? Is it A, 1990, B, 1994, C, 1998, or D, 2002? You guys can answer the question by drop your answer at the comment box for each platform of our social media live. And for those of you guys who are tuning in from Facebook, Periscope, Twitter, and our YouTube channel, you guys can drop your question for the Q&A section later on at the comment box section so that our panelists can answer you directly. Okay, I think that's it for me. Don't forget to tune in until the end of the program because I will give live shout out to you guys with the correct answer. All right, and one more thing, don't forget to take a selfie and tag Ad America's Instagram account during the event. I think that's it for me. I'll see you guys again at the end of the event. And now, I'd like to pass it to our moderator for tonight. Please welcome April Sirait, Senior Assignment Editor from CNN Indonesia TV. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Vivi, for the introduction and opening. Hello, everyone. Good evening. Welcome to this webinar on ending violence against Indonesian women and girls through strong policies supported by USAID Indonesia and Ad America. I'm April Sirait. I'm an assignment editor of CNN Indonesia TV based in Jakarta. I'm moderating tonight's discussion. Data shows nearly one in three women will experience violence in their lifetime, and intimate partner violence is the most common form of violence experienced by women globally. Gender-based violence, or GBV, comprises various human rights violations, including sexual violence, exploitation, and abuse. During the COVID-19 pandemic, the number of gender-based violence cases in Indonesia is even more increasing than before. The online survey conducted by the National Commission on Violence Against Women shows a 12% increase in GBV rates during the pandemic in 2020 across 34 provinces in Indonesia, compared with reported incidents in 2019. And meanwhile, the United States has a strong interest in preventing and responding to gender-based violence around the world. USAID Indonesia gets involved to combat gender-based violence through medical care, counseling, legal assistance, and community awareness programs, strengthening the referral system for GBV survivors, services, and policy advocacy. And before we start our discussion, I would like to welcome the USAID Mission Director, Ryan Westburn, to give us our opening remarks. Mr. Ryan.
Thank you, and selamat malam, Ibu Vanessa, Ibu
selamat
Dia, dan Citra.
Selamat malam, ya. Good evening.
Good evening. Selamat malam semuanya yang mengikuti acara malam ini. Saya senang sekali bisa menghadiri acara ini bersama Anda semua. Nama saya Ryan Washburn, Direktur Padan Pembangunan Internasional Amerika Serikat atau USAID di Indonesia. Pertama-tama saya akan menjelaskan sedikit tentang apa itu USAID. Sebagai badan pembangunan internasional, kami mendukung pembangunan di Indonesia di berbagai bidang seperti kesehatan, hak asasi manusia, demokrasi, pengelolaan, sumber daya alam berkelanjutan, penenggambangan, keterampilan kerja anak muda, dan masih banyak lagi. Inti dari berbagai kegiatan kami adalah kepercayaan bahwa kesetaraan gender memiliki kemampuan transformatif yang membawa perubahan baik bagi keluarga, masyarakat maupun negara Indonesia. USA berpartisipasi dalam kampanye 16 hari melawan kerja kekerasan berbasis gender setiap tahun. Tema tahun ini adalah Orange the World, Fund, Respond, Prevent, Collect. Tema ini berarti menjabatini kesenjangan pendanaan dan memastikan layanan penting untuk penyintas tetap tersedia dalam masa pandemi COVID-19. Bahkan sebelum COVID-19, perempuan dan anak perempuan menghadapi pandemi yang lain, yaitu pandemi kekerasan. Tahun ini sangat disayangkan bahwa angka kekerasan terhadap perempuan meningkat di seluruh dunia. Sebagian besar disebabkan oleh stres karena adanya lockdown atau PSBB dan ketidakpastian ekonomi. Untuk mendukung dan melindungi perempuan dan anak-anak perempuan, USAID membantu mereka mendapatkan pengobatan, counseling, dan bantuan hukum yang dibutuhkan. Kami memperluas kesadaran dan pengetahuan tentang GBV dan memperkuat sistem rujukan untuk para penyintas. Dan yang paling penting, kami terus mendukung kebijakan yang akan membawa perubahan baik dalam jangka panjang. Hari ini, malam ini, kita akan belajar dari para pembicara tentang bagaimana merapatkan upaya kita untuk mengakhiri kekerasan berbasis gender melalui kebijakan dan undang-undang. Terima kasih atas perhatian, minat, dan komitmen Anda semua untuk mengakhiri GBV. Selamat mengikuti dan terima kasih.
Terima kasih banyak Bapak Ryan Washburn for the opening remarks. And before we start our discussion, I will invite three speakers also to discuss more about this topic. But I would like to say hello to our special audience. They are college students from Sekolah Tinggi Ilmu Pemerintahan STPP from Bung Hatta University and also President University. Thank you so much for joining this event. And also to all audience, even the media who participate in this event, you can also participate in this discussion. I will read your questions or comments during Q&A session. So please send your questions to AdAmerica social media platforms on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and also Twitter. Now joining with us, three speakers ready to share their professional expertise in these global issues. First, we have Ibu Venesia Recurrence Danes, Deputy Minister of Women's Rights Protections, joining us all the way from Manado, Ibu. Hello, Ibu. Apa kabar?
Hello.
Yeah. Ibu, as the Minister Deputy, she coordinates with stakeholders to ensure that through the strategy of gender mainstreaming program and its activities related to gender equality are implemented not only by the government institution at national level, but also down to the provincial level and to the districts. And the second speakers, we have Ibu Dia Pitaloka, Women Caucus Chairperson, House of Representatives. Hi, Ibu Dia. Selamat malam, Ibu.
Selamat malam, Mbak.
Ibu, apa kabar?
Baik, baik.
Okay. Ibu Dia has been the parliamentary member since 2014 in the PDIP. She is now a member of Commission's 8 of the House of Representatives and part of Legislation Council, or BALE. She is assigned as the chairperson of Women Caucus in the House of Representatives for the period of 2020 and 2024. And last but not least, we have Chaitra Senoy, USAID Washington Senior Gender-Based Violence Advisor, joining us early in the morning from Washington, D.C. Hi, Chay. How are you?
Doing well. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Chay, for joining us tonight. Really appreciate it. Chaitra Senoy is an attorney and technical expert in the field of gender-based violence. And since 2016, Ms. Senoy has worked at the U.S. Agency for International Development, or USAID, providing guidance on programming, addressing gaps, and determining a trends for research on gender-based violence in her capacity as the gender-based violence advisors. And for the first presentation, we'll start from Ibu Venesia. Ibu, silakan.
Yeah, hello. Hi, everybody. Selamat malam. The Honorable Mr. Ryan Washburn, Director of USAID Mission in Indonesia. The speakers, the Honorable Ibu Dia Pitaloka, the Chairperson of Women Caucus and Member of House of Representatives. Ms. Chaitra Shenoy, the Senior Gender-Based Violence Advisor of USAID Headquarters, and all the participants and attendees. I heard that from the universities, such as the Bung Hatta University, that become some all of you here. So we welcome to this webinar. Of course, we have to say peace upon us because of the God mercies and blessing that this evening we can conduct this occasion in the midst of pandemic COVID-19. Praise and gratitude we pray to the presence of God Almighty, because with His grace and mercy we can participate in this activity in a healthy state. On this occasion, I express appreciation for the convening of this webinar with the theme Ending Violence Against Women and Girls in Indonesia through Strengthened Policies and Regulations. In view of violence against women and children is still increasing every year. This inconsistent with data on violence against women based on the 2016, next slide please, National Women's Life Experience Survey, or SPHPN, which we conduct in the 2016, which shows us that one in three women aged 15 to 64 years have experienced physical violence or sexual violence. One in four women who have been or are currently married have experienced economic-based violence, and one in five women who have or are currently married experience psychological violence. The data from Symphony, which is the data that belongs to the Ministry of Women Empowerment and Child Protection, from January 1 to the December 4, 2020, based on the reporting year, shows that cases of violence against women, or VAW, were 6,502 cases, while domestic violence cases, 3,959 cases. The data above is an iceberg phenomenon. Only cases have been reported, and there are still many cases that have not been reported. From this data, it is enough to convince us that violence against women, especially domestic violence, is a serious problem for us to find a solution. For this reason, it is necessary to increase understanding, common perception, and joint commitment from central and regional stakeholders together with the community to prevent and anticipate from an early stage of violence against women or gender-based violence cases. Thus, to prevent violence against women and children, needed a comprehensive breakthrough effort that involves all components included in the village's community. In this respect, it is important to realize a region friendly to women and eligible children. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. On February 21, 2020, the Ministry of Women Empowerment and Child Protection has made the Declaration Model of Free Domestic Violence, or DV Village, in the village of Bayan District, Sukadana, North Lombok. The declaration of the free DV village model is one of the implementation of the Elimination of Domestic Violence EDV law. Through the free DV village model, it is hoped that it can be replicated for other villages. Next slide, please. In line with this recently, 11 November 2020, Women Friendly Village and Child Worthy Village have been launched as a strategy for achieving SDGs which is a collaboration between the Ministry of Women Empowerment Child Protection and the Ministry of Underdeveloped Rural Development and Transmigration. The narration of the President of the Republic of Indonesia to the Minister of Women Empowerment and Child Protection includes firstly is empowerment of women in the entrepreneurship. The second one, increasing the role of mothers in children's education. The third one, reducing violence against women and children. Fourthly, decrease in child labor. And fifthly, is prevention of child marriage. Therefore, in an effort to reduce cases of violence, it is necessary to take strategic steps ranging from prevention, handling to empowerment, including creating an area of free of violence. In addition, based on the result of the close meeting on January 9, 2020, mandating that the following matters, which is priority on violence prevention and action, number two, which is improve the reporting system and complaint services. The third one, carry out major reforms in the management of handling cases of violence against women and children by establishing one-stop services so that handling can be carried out quickly, integrated, and comprehensively. The fourth one is implementing a deterrent effect of law enforcement and provide legal aid assistance services. And the fifth is to provide social rehabilitation and social reintegration services. Ladies and gentlemen and happy audience, we need to know together that the concept of the rule of law to achieve a prosperous society is implicitly contained in the preamble of the fourth paragraph of the 1945 Constitution, namely the state protects the entire nation and all Indonesian homeland, advances public welfare, educates the nation's life, and participates in implementing order, a world based on freedom, lasting peace, and social justice. In order to achieve that, there should be good governance. For this reason, legality is needed in every action that is carried out, which means that all action must be justified from legal norms. The state is of the view that all forms of violence are violation of human rights and crimes against humanity, dignity, and discrimination that must be eliminated. The fulfillment of the right to be free from threats, discrimination, and violence is a very, very important right to be realized because it is related to other constitutional rights, namely the right to protection and the right to justice. But the reality in the field shows that the victims of violence are mostly women and children, so that the state and society must provide protection to women and children in order to avoid and be free from violence or threats of violence, torture, or treatment that degrading humanity. This is in line with the commitment of the state and the government, which guarantees the right of every citizen to feel safe and free from all forms of violence and discrimination as regulated in the 1945 Constitution Article 28G, paragraph 1, which states that everyone has the right to self-protection, personal, family, honor, dignity, and property under their control, and are entitled to a sense of security and protection from the threat of fear to do or not to do something that is a human right. And it is also regulated in Article 28H, paragraph 2, that everyone has the right to get special facilities and treatment to get the same opportunities and benefits in order to achieve quality and justice. Ladies and gentlemen, and happy audience, the law of ending domestic violence states that the parameters for eliminating domestic violence are based on four principles. Namely, I think next slide. One is respect for human rights. Mm-hmm. And then the second one is gender justice and equality. Third one is non-discrimination, and the fourth one is protections of victims. Article 4 of the law explains that the goal of eliminating domestic violence is preventing all forms of domestic violence, and the second one to protect victims of domestic violence. Third one is to take action against perpetrators of domestic violence, and the fourth one is to maintain their harmonious and prosperous household integrity. Thus, it is hoped that various acts of domestic violence that have been rife so far can be eliminated and as far as possible eliminated in people's life. Forms of the rights of women who have experienced acts of domestic violence include getting protection from the Women and Child Protection Police Unit, which is WCPPU, getting information about the existence of a place for complaints, getting integrated services, getting guaranteed rights, their rights as a wife, as a mother, as a child in the household, and then to receive psychological, medical, and legal assistance. Also to receive ongoing treatment until the rehabilitation stage. Forms of protection for the rights of women who experience act of violence in household are providing assistance to victims of domestic violence, providing services, providing safe houses, which means temporary accommodation for victims. Ladies and gentlemen and happy audience, one of the forms of a violence that occurs in society is sexual violence that form a crime that is becoming a problem of global and very worried about every country in the world. Not only occur in the developing countries, but also occurred in the countries that care and respect the human basic right. Sexual violence in Indonesia, especially against women and children, is very worrying because the cases tend to increase. Therefore, in overcoming the occurrence of the such violence, a legal protection breakthrough is needed in the form of ESV law, or ending sexual violence law. Borrowing a term from Pope John Paul II, which is say that sexual violence against children and women is a graviora delicta, which means the most serious crime. Why is that? Because women and children are vulnerable groups that should be protected, but instead become objects of crime. Until now, there have been many cases of sexual violence against children and women. The irony is that there are only a few cases where total enforcement can be done. If this is the case, then in order to tackle sexual violence in the future, state intervention must be carried out by hastening the passing of the bill on the elimination of sexual violence, which is victim-oriented, including the formulation of offenses and the handling and recovery of victims, not only punishing the perpetrator, but more than that, there must be reparation for the victim, including psychological assistance. Because the substance of this bill is graviora delicta, it is deemed appropriate to be regulated in a criminal bill or litigative, so that the legal approach is appropriate as a criminal law, where the criminalization is an effort of primum remedium, or the main antidote, which is different from the administrative law, which is the main antidote, which is different from the administrative law, where criminalization is an effort of ultimum remedium, or last antidote. Next slide, please. The condition related to government support. Okay, there's one more and then that's it. The condition is related to government support for the ESV bill have not changed so far, namely that they continue to support the passing of the ESV bill into law. The government's most obvious commitment in the elimination of sexual violence is to be directly and actively involved in the drafting of ending sexual violence bill. The government for the first time officially stated it is commitment to support the ending sexual violence bill on February 2016, 3 months before the ESV bill was included in the list of national legislative bill priority program in May 2016, through the government's view on the need for the ESV bill, which was conveyed by the Women, Environment and Child Protection Minister at a working meeting with Senate of the Republic of Indonesia Committee 3 with the following reason. One, the bill on the elimination of sexual violence is a substantially intended to protect women and children from acts of sexual violence, which includes prevention, protection for victims, handling and recovery of victims. There is no legal protection for handling sexual violence in the public sphere. This commitment was reinforced again in the presidential opinion regarding the ending of sexual violence bill which was read out by the Minister of Women Empowerment and Child Protection on September 11, 2017 at a meeting of the Government Working Committee and the HR to discuss together the SV bill. Where is principle, the government agree with the House of Representatives of the Republic of Indonesia, which proposed the ESV bill. Judging from the urgency of the ESV bill, it has received support from various parties, including the commitment of the head of the ministry, institution, stakeholders in the preparation of the ESV bill, academics, human rights activists, service institution forums, students, community leaders, religious leaders, community organization, organization religion, and the business world. It is hoped that the passage of this bill will become a central complement as a clear evidence of strengthening global policies and regulation in fulfilling the commitment to protect women's rights both nationally and internationally. Thus, the violence against women and girls can be eliminated. Ladies and gentlemen, everybody who attends this webinar, these are some of the things that we convey regarding strengthening government policy and regulation policies to end violence against women and girls in Indonesia, and hopefully this will be useful. Congratulations on the participating in this activity and discussion. Good luck. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Shalom. Om Santi 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 Om. Sadu 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 Sadu. Salam kebajikan dan salam NKRI. Terima kasih.
Baik, terima kasih Ibu Fene atas penjelasannya. Thank you, Ibu Fene, for the presentation. It's such an opening information that you share with us. And one thing that I highlighted from your presentation is there is still a culture of silence on the this gender-based violence on the policymakers and also the victims themselves, which we will discuss further with another speakers. But before that, we're going to watch a USAID animated message on this issue. Okay, for the next presentations, we have Ibu Dia Pitaloka, Women Caucus Chairpersons, House of Representatives.
Terima kasih. Izinkan saya menggunakan bahasa Indonesia. Selamat malam. Senang sekali bisa hadir malam ini. Yang saya hormati, Mr. Ryan Washburn, USAID Mission Director, lalu Ibu Fene, saya bilangnya, okay. Ibu, halo Venesia ya, Danes, iya, Deputi Perlindungan Hak Perempuan di Kementerian Pemberdayaan Perempuan dan Perlindungan Anak. Lalu Mrs. Chaitra Sefoy, USAID Washington Senior GBV Advisor. Ya tentunya undang-undang ini bertahan cukup panjang di dalam perhatian publik setelah banyak kejadian di periode DPR tahun masa jabatan sebelumnya 2014-2019. Dari awal advokasinya saya mengikuti mungkin sejak 2016. Lalu draft ini sebagai usulan masuk menjadi usulan inisiatif DPR. Lalu dibahas di Komisi 8. Komisi 8 itu membidangi persoalan sosial, keagamaan, pemberdayaan perempuan dan anak, lalu bencana alam. Hal-hal yang bidang-bidang yang menurut saya sebetulnya sangat dekat dengan perspektif atau keberpihakan terhadap mereka yang lemah ya, terutama di Kementerian Sosial dan Pemberdayaan Perempuan dan Anak. lalu juga bencana alam, tentu nilai kemanusiaannya cukup tinggi di bidang-bidang itu. Dan draft ini dibahas, kalau dibilang panjang, mungkin prosesnya panjang ketika mendapatkan masukan-masukan dari berbagai pihak. Dan pada saat itu juga sempat berada di dalam tahapan pembahasan ketika masa pemilu, pemilu presiden dan legislatif, sehingga kontroversinya cukup tinggi juga gitu, antara yang setuju dan tidak menyetujui. Nah, yang tidak menyetujui tentunya banyak perspektif, cara pandang sebetulnya ya, cara melihat bahwa kekerasan seksual ini di beberapa definisi itu menimbulkan pertanyaan di dalam pembahasan di DPR, misalnya bagaimana menerjemahkan kata hasrat seksual, atau bagaimana membaca definisinya ada relasi hubungan kuasa gitu ya, antara korban dan pelaku. Nah, hal-hal ini yang secara budaya kemudian banyak dipertanyakan bagi mereka yang tidak setuju, tidak hanya anggota DPR, tapi juga banyak orang yang mempertanyakan hal-hal itu, di samping banyak juga keprihatinan atau perhatian publik terhadap kebutuhan akan satu regulasi, satu bill, satu undang-undang menyangkut kekerasan seksual, yang karena fenomenanya yang tadi sudah dijelaskan oleh Ibu Vene, fenomenanya meningkat, apalagi di tengah pandemi juga trennya ternyata kekerasan ketika pandemi ini juga banyak sekali ditemukan gitu ya. Mungkin karena tadi kita lihat sebagian besar ada tekanan-tekanan ekonomi di dalam keluarga, juga persoalan-persoalan yang secara sosiokultural itu sangat dekat kemudian menimpa kaum perempuan. Nah, ini ya, walaupun undang-undang ini tidak hanya ditujukan bagi perempuan, tapi juga bagi laki-laki yang banyak juga mengalami problematika kekerasan seksual. Nah, di tengah perdebatan itu, undang-undang ini kemudian terhenti pembahasannya, sebetulnya tidak diselesaikan. Kita waktu itu sudah coba untuk percepat gitu ya, atau pembahasannya, tapi sebagian dari anggota DPR di Komisi 8 yang pada saat itu secara paradigma tidak setuju, itu cenderung melambatkan proses gitu, atau memanjangkan prosesnya, sehingga akhirnya kita kehabisan waktu masa jabatan anggota DPR. Dan masuk kemudian, karena saya kebetulan masuk Komisi 8 lagi, di masa jabatan anggota DPR 2019-2024, undang-undang ini saya usulkan kembali masuk Komisi 8. Seperti janji saya sebelumnya pada periode lalu, ketika undang-undang ini di-drop, tidak bisa diselesaikan, kita usulkan lagi. Dan oleh Komisi 8 memang di tarik untuk kemudian dikoordinasikan dengan badan legislasi untuk dibawa pembahasannya di dalam pembahasan badan legislasi. Dan kemudian saya masuk kembali ke dalam badan legislasi, dan memang kita kehilangan momentum prolegnas 2020, undang-undang ini di-drop, tidak masuk menjadi prolegnas prioritas. Tapi masih ada di dalam prolegnas, di dalam list prolegnas, program legislasi nasional. Nah, sehingga ketika di-drop itu menimbulkan kritik dari publik sangat tinggi, mungkin sampai hari ini juga publik sangat memperhatikan bagaimana diharapkan undang-undang ini segera dibahas di 2020. Kenapa itu belum bisa diproses di balik? Karena memang tidak ada kesiapan naskah akademik yang rencananya dan hari ini sudah kita terima itu direvisi. Jadi secara teknis memang belum ada kesiapan teknis. Dan secara prosedur butuh waktu memindahkan prosesnya dari usulan Komisi 8 menjadi usulan balik. Yang mungkin saya berharap di balik lebih banyak mendapatkan persetujuan, atau pembahasannya akan bisa lebih eksploratif. Karena tantangan undang-undang ini sendiri sebetulnya adalah bagaimana mengkolaborasi atau mengharmonisasi berbagai perundang-undangan, yang baik undang-undang KUHP, TPPO, Undang-Undang Perlindungan Anak. Di situ juga banyak pasal-pasal yang mencantumkan kekerasan seksual dengan pemahaman yang berbeda. Kalau di KUHP itu lebih persoalan kesusilaan ya. Jadi bukan dalam kerangka menjaga integritas tubuh atau menjaga integritas keselamatan seseorang, hak seseorang gitu, tapi lebih ranah kesusilaan, artinya untuk tidak dipermalukan, untuk melindungi dari ruang sosial, cara pemahamannya berbeda. Nah, ini sebetulnya tantangannya menarik sekali. Jadi nanti saya rasa pembahasannya di balik akan cukup cukup dalam, karena bagaimana menyamakan perspektif dari berbagai undang-undang yang sekarang berlangsung dan juga mungkin konsepsi hukuman-hukuman pidana, pemberatan, dan lain-lain di berbagai undang-undang yang sudah termaktub, tapi bukan berarti undang-undang ini kemudian patah, tapi diharapkan undang-undang ini bisa mensinkronize, mengharmonisasi, agar pasal-pasal menyangkut kekerasan seksual di dalam hukum Indonesia itu bisa lebih walkable gitu ya, bisa lebih dapat lebih dapat diimplementasikan untuk menghadirkan keadilan bagi para korban. Nah, ini sebetulnya tantangan yang menarik, dan insya Allah bulan depan mungkin kita bahas lagi prolegnas untuk ditetapkan, dan undang-undang ini sudah menjadi on the list, sudah menjadi bagian dari list yang diusulkan oleh Partai PDI Perjuangan, PKB, dan Nasdem, juga pengusul, dan kita juga sudah mulai membahas bertiga bagaimana undang-undang ini akan kita usulkan gitu, mungkin pemaparannya, kontennya, dan lain-lain. Ini tentu menarik sekali. Dan yang kedua, sebagai kaukus parlemen, kaukus perempuan di parlemen, dan ini apa peran kaukus gitu, tadi pertanyaan yang ada pada saya, peran kaukus menjadi kita anggota-anggotanya banyak mengkomunikasikan betapa pentingnya undang-undang ini ke dalam partai masing-masing, ke dalam fraksi masing-masing. Kita juga berapa kali mengadakan diskusi sehingga menimbulkan persoalan atau concern, perhatian yang sama dengan sesama anggota parlemen perempuan, tidak hanya DPR tapi juga DPD. Dan tentunya kaukus menjadi ruang yang sangat komunikatif gitu ya. Dia ruang komunikasi yang menurut saya bisa jadi sangat membantu kita melakukan lobby-lobby di dalam parlemen dalam menggolkan undang-undang ini gitu. Karena tidak hanya melalui forum-forum formal, tapi kita berharap keanggotaan kaukus yang isinya semua partai politik yang ada di dalam parlemen dan juga anggota DPD, dan bagaimana mengendorse isu ini menjadi isu publik juga di wilayah masing-masing, memberikan penjelasan, itu bisa sangat membantu dalam proses bagaimana kita bisa sampai terhadap pengesahan undang-undang ini. Mungkin demikian dari saya.
Baik. Terima kasih. Terima kasih Ibu Dia atas penjelasannya. Thank you for your explanation, Ibu Dia. So Ibu Dia admitted that it is very challenging to pass the highly anti-san perempuan, because as we know that this bill excluded from the list of the regulation in a meeting in the House of Legislation last July. So it means that it is dropped from this year's National Legislation Program or Prolegnas, ya Ibu ya. But there are different perspectives among members of parliaments about this issue, because this issue interlink with some other factors such as religious views and also different interpretations of violence or harassments. But Ibu Dia stated that this bill actually is still being on the list for the next year discussion among the members of parliament. Thank you, Ibu Dia. And next we have Chaitra Senoy, Senior Gender-Based Violence Advisors from USAID.
Thank you so much for inviting me. It's hard act to follow, both from not only the mission director, Washburn from USAID Indonesia, but Professor Venetia and Dia, it's very hard to follow all of this great information that you have laid out. And thank you, April, for moderating and doing such a great job. As April mentioned, my name is Chaitra Shenoy, and I'm the gender-based violence advisor, and I sit in USAID Washington. So It is truly an honor to be sitting with you all from Indonesia and to be having a discussion on an issue that is obviously hits close to home, as GBV affects all countries that USAID has presence in. I'm going to talk today about the issue of gender-based violence as it relates to COVID-19. This year, globally, we faced an unprecedented pandemic, and this pandemic has had a huge impact on countries worldwide. When the pandemic hit, USAID stood up a COVID-19 task force to manage USAID resources and implementation of those resources across USAID countries. In May, I was asked to join that task force to provide gender and gender-based violence integration and policy recommendations, specifically on how to integrate gender-based violence into our COVID-19 programming. And I noticed that many programs, since there were programs that dealt with food security, health, all the first kind of responding programs, were struggling on how to prevent and respond to gender-based violence. And yet almost every single partner that we worked with stated that they saw the gender inequities and violence that they heard was happening in the communities and specifically in homes. The extended quarantine and necessary public health measures have created a set of social conditions that have increased the likelihood of gender-based violence. We've heard this from the professor and from the representative talking about the 12% increase of gender-based violence in Indonesia as compared to last time, as compared to last year around this time. We know that this number is far more higher than what we are getting from the hotlines and from women's organizations and hospitals and community health workers. We know that many women and girls and boys are not coming forward and reporting the sexual violence and the intimate partner violence that's happening. We also know that this is happening again across the global landscape. There's been an increase of child marriage, an increase of female genital mutilation and cutting, sexual exploitation and abuse, and of course, trafficking in persons has increased. The specific issue of domestic and intimate partner violence takes a variety of different forms, particularly as it relates to this pandemic. It can be withholding very important equipment like hand sanitizer or protective equipment like masks. It could be suppressing access to food, providing misinformation about COVID-19, and preventing women and children from seeking medical attention. Next slide, please. To mitigate the impact of the pandemic, it is critical to identify and adapt our various development programming and other forms of programming that's happening in Indonesia and around the world to address how COVID-19 is affecting women and girls and men and boys of different ages, abilities, socioeconomic and demographic groups. Incidents of GBV are expected to continue and to increase during this pandemic as it continues to ravage so many countries. Movement will be curtailed, social services will continue to be limited and or closed, resources will become scarce and households will face increased economic and communal pressures. And I know that you all know this data and you all are well aware of the impact of COVID-19, but nonetheless, we must remain vigilant and continue to track these trends in both in terms of our national trends as well as our sub-regional and even local trends of gender-based violence and the impact that it's having for a variety of different sectors and forms, so that we can continue to address and end gender-based violence. Next slide, please. the data around gender-based violence showed, again, these are, I'm going to be showing some data trends for global impact. Early data in the spring, so March and April of 2020, showed that calls to domestic violence were increased by 30% in a variety of different countries. Again, as I mentioned right before, this is assumed because of the exacerbated stress that families have been facing with stay-at-home orders and the economic shocks that have occurred where businesses and jobs have been eliminated. I wanted to also showcase that this issue is not just happening in Asia or Indonesia, but it's happening in all parts of the world. I pulled out a statistic of children in Latin America and the Caribbean. 97% of children are still out of school, meaning that they're not getting education in school. So most schools have moved into digital spaces with online schooling. However, this has disrupted educational gains that have been made over the last several decades and has disproportionately impacted girls, leading to some adverse outcomes such as child marriage. Next slide. What is interesting is that the focus that I'm pushing for this particular discussion is the focus around the access to education, because we know education is one of those protective factors around addressing and working with youth in addressing gender-based violence and preventing gender-based violence, as well as addressing GBV with families, with teachers and administrators. School-based gender-based violence prevention activities have had to pivot. They've had to go into digital spaces, which amplifies the access issues that we face in several countries, including in Indonesia, where access to the internet and stable internet in rural and impoverished populations are extremely hard to reach. Standard GBV reporting pathways are decreased as children who have reported gender-based violence or that they're either witnessing or experiencing to teachers and to community leaders within the school are being left vulnerable. Mm-hmm. Next slide, please. So this issue leads to several different recommendations that I'm here to share with you all. These recommendations we think are not only critical to addressing COVID-19, because without addressing gender-based violence and the risks to our communities, we're not going to be, which includes gender-based violence, it's going to be very challenging to reduce COVID-19. The first issue that, that first recommendation that we have is centering all of our programming and any decisions that, that nations are making and communities are making, centering it around women and girls. They need to be even more integrated into design and decision-making processes, and survivor voices need to be leading the conversation on risk mitigation. We also believe that economic support can occur, but it needs to occur without creating a larger risk of gender-based violence. And so there are different ways that businesses have approached the economic growth opportunities while working with women during COVID-19 to make sure that economic disruptions are not happening and that businesses can become first-line responders to gender-based violence. So adapting livelihood activities to identify and mitigate those challenges and including survivors of gender-based violence might experience the ability to receive economic relief and support. This could include cash transfer programs. It could include also targeting economic support along with case management, which is our next recommendation. We've recognized for several years that as health systems are moving towards digital spaces, that gender-based violence case management services and protocols also need to be updated and adapted. The diversion of health resources, social distancing, stay-at-home orders have rendered gender-based violence case management almost difficult. They've been difficult to access, and we have to change the way that we provide responses, that we are responsive to GBV survivors. So that can include strengthening the capacity of existing providers who support GBV survivors to adapt case management protocols, incorporate remote responses through digital technology as available, and ensure continued support for survivors, even during social distancing. We also need to raise awareness of our healthcare providers of the increased risk of violence. We have received several reports of frontline workers who are healthcare workers who tend to be female being at risk for violence from their patients and from community members. And so doing some, being aware of that violence and ensuring that they are trained to address gender-based violence is another key component from COVID-19 that we'd like to see integrated into healthcare response. The other response that we are starting to see across the globe is this issue of mental health and the need for mental health and psychosocial support services to survivors. The diversion of mental health resources to COVID-19 has meant that survivors have had limited access to these really critical support services. So we need to continue to update referral pathways to include mental health, first of all, for survivors of GBV, and that mental health services needs to be culturally competent and ensure that it reflects the needs of the community. We need to increase the availability of virtual or localized services that include phone, online, and remote services, and need to ensure that services are being established through community focal points and working with existing networks to provide mental health services. Next slide, please. Our recommendations also include some of the issues that were brought up by the previous speakers. This includes ensuring access to justice and to our police. These critical services have been all but closed in many, many communities, and they are being overwhelmed by the pandemic, creating almost an atmosphere of impunity for GBV perpetrators, which keeps this pandemic of gender-based violence unchecked. Furthermore, not only are police and justice system actors, they need to be trained to address reporting gender-based violence using survivor-centered approaches, and police and other security forces are sometimes perpetrators of gender-based violence. So our recommendations continue to be ensuring that law enforcement and justice systems are trained to provide survivor-centered intake to support and link survivors of gender-based violence with trained law enforcement practitioners as well as judicial practitioners, and facilitate the development of confidential remote disclosure and legal processes, including remote hearings that can happen both online and offline using our social distancing measures. We also recognize back in May, while I joined the task force, that as I mentioned, that many of our partners were needing training on how to handle disclosures of gender-based violence and referral of the gender-based violence survivors to trained providers. So strengthening those referral pathways, even in organizations and partners that traditionally don't address gender equality or gender-based violence, they were now receiving gender-based violence disclosures. So we need to increase our awareness and increase our connection to women's organizations, domestic violence organizations, and other organizations that are working with vulnerable populations in addressing gender-based violence. And finally, last but not least, I will close on technology. we're using technology right now to address and to build awareness around gender-based violence, we need to continue to adapt and use technology to support GBV survivors. There's been increased care demands because of social distancing on women and girls. There is going to be a huge gap around literacy for boys and girls that have been affected by COVID-19. And there's also a lack of access to technology. And many services have moved to the technology space, the digital space, for economic transfers, so to be able to do business. And if women who are generally the buyers of home needs are not having technology, are not having the digital cell phone or, you know, an upgraded cell phone to address all the new technology, women are now being cut out of the decision making in the family household, and that expands into the community and it expands into the systems. So we need to collaborate with our community networks to make sure that GBV survivors are getting access to technology. We also need to make sure that our messaging to survivors are also we're using digital spaces to make that messaging clear. It needs to be clear, simple, concise, and made into languages that are affected by gender-based violence. Not promote the stigma associated with reporting gender-based violence, and make sure that we're using mixed media strategies and forms of that do not require reading literacy. We really do believe at USAID that all of these recommendations can be implemented on a national and sub-regional levels, and it really does go back to the first recommendation that women, boys, girls need to be involved in the decision making of any pandemic response, including the ongoing pandemic of COVID-19. And with that, I will end and hand it back over to April. Thank you.
Thank you, Chai, for the most updated data and programs that USAID has been doing during this pandemic. It's really shocking as well that I pinpoint like 30% increasing number of GBV cases in countries like France, Argentina, and Singapore, and also like 97% of children in Latin America and Caribbean struggling with educations because of this pandemic. Seperti yang tadi dijelaskan sama Ibu Chay, bahwa USA sendiri sebenarnya juga mengalami kendala dalam menangani gender-based violence, karena pandemi ini mempersulit akses wanita atau perempuan untuk meminta bantuan karena mereka harus di-link sama krisis dan juga beberapa faktor-faktor lain seperti keadaan ekonomi maupun keadaan sosial yang tidak memungkinkan mereka untuk berinteraksi dengan orang lain. Bahkan USAID sendiri juga membentuk satgas untuk tetap memonitor kasus-kasus pelecehan ataupun pelanggaran hak asasi manusia untuk perempuan dan juga anak. Dan satu hal yang tadi dibagi oleh Ibu Chay adalah ternyata kasus pelanggaran HAM atau pelecehan terhadap perempuan dan anak juga di negara lain terdata meningkat selama pandemi, seperti di negara Prancis, Argentina, dan juga Singapura naik sebesar 30%. Bahkan ada juga data menunjukkan 97% anak-anak di Amerika Latin dan juga Kepulauan Karibia pada akhirnya mereka tidak punya akses pendidikan dengan menggunakan akses digital, mereka akhirnya berakhir di pernikahan dini karena mereka tidak bisa mengakomodasi kebutuhan mereka sehari-hari. Okay, that's all the presentation from our speakers, and we're gonna go move on to the Q&A sessions. But while waiting for the questions coming in from our audience, I have questions for Ibu Fene and Ibu Dia. So what do you think that we should take as an effort to reduce gender-based violence in Indonesia, because the bills has not been passed this year? Ibu Fene mungkin bisa mulai.
have the, this is, it's not the leg specialist, but we have still have the law, undang-undang KUHP ya. Undang-undang KUHP, kemudian we have also the, there's see the in term of the what is it of the law ya, yeah? We have the undang-undang KUHP, although it's not the leg specialist, but we still have that one to protect for people that doing the, I mean, the sexual harassment and then all like what is it apa namanya kekerasan-kekerasan lainnya yang mengakibatkan korban jiwa dan lain sebagainya. Kita juga masih memiliki undang-undang PKDRT, undang-undang nomor 3, we have the law number 23 2004 regarding the ending domestic violence, undang-undang pemberantasan kekerasan dalam rumah tangga. Kita juga masih memiliki undang-undang TPPO, yaitu we have the law number 21 2007 regarding the trafficking in person of human trafficking. So if it is the case of sexual and then exploitation and stuff like that, we have we use that umbrella. And then what is it, we still have a couple of the law that for to protect the children, you know, some of the law that we can use. However, you know, we want to this bill to pass because it's very crucial, because there are some things that the types of the sexual harassment and the sexual abuse that there are couple of categories, you know, from the mild to the very, 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 what is it, very moderate and then very, very heavy, you know, heavy, what is it, violence, yeah? Yeah. Also, in terms of prevention, for sure, that we do the socialization and dissemination regarding the law. And then now, because we have one more function from the president, which is the referral, Ministry of Women Empowerment become a referral institution, you know, the last referral for the, you know, from the level of a district, and then, what is it, sub-districts, and then to the provincial level, and then to us. So we still have the give the protection to the women, victims of violence or children victim of violence, in term of apa namanya pendampingan ya, how we call in English pendampingan dan lain sebagainya. Kemudian juga memberikan apa namanya bantuan hukum, memberikan shelter dan lain sebagainya. Kalau memang ada kasus-kasus seperti itu, tapi prevention is much better than cure. We have to disseminate all the law that exist that are existing right now, you know, while waiting for the special like specialist law such as the ending sexual violence like that. I think.
Okay, Bu Fene, still from Enda Sofiani send a questions to at America Facebook untuk Ibu Dia. What are the steps to take for women caucus to encourage the parliament to pass the bill? Apa yang perlu dilakukan oleh Komisi 8, Bu, untuk pada akhirnya bill ini bisa diterima menjadi undang-undang? Mungkin tidak tahun ini, sudah tidak mungkin ya, Bu, berarti tahun depan. Langkah apa saja yang perlu diambil?
Ya. Terima kasih pertanyaannya, menarik sekali. Saya jadi memikirkan beberapa hal. Pertama, perjuangan legislasi itu ada di level legislation ya, artinya dia ada perjuangan menyangkut undang-undang ataupun norma. Nah, tapi saya menambahkan yang Bu Feni sudah jelaskan, ada berbagai undang-undang yang hari ini mengalami persoalan dalam perjuangan hukum. Artinya misalnya undang-undang KDRT itu ada, tapi orang tidak mengakses undang-undang itu untuk mempersoalkan kekerasan dalam rumah tangga di rumah tangganya. Nah, berarti mungkin ada beberapa jalan, karena kenyataannya kita berhadapan dengan tingkat kekerasan baik terhadap anak, perempuan, ataupun kalangan yang secara sosial lemah gitu ya. Nah, mungkin caranya adalah dengan membangun satu program atau satu pendekatan. Tadi bagus sekali dijelaskan oleh Mrs. Chai bagaimana ada misalnya pendampingan itu berjalan gitu ya, artinya ada konseling, ada sharing dari para penyintas gitu ya, ada dari survivor gitu ya, itu ada membuat komunikasi, dan ini menurut saya ketika undang-undang dibahas, upaya-upaya untuk mencegah atau mengatasi persoalan kekerasan seksual itu harus tetap diupayakan baik oleh pemerintah pusat ataupun pemerintah daerah. Nah, karena kita tidak bisa, sebetulnya norma yang ada hari ini ada KUHP, ada undang-undang TPPO, ada undang-undang kekerasan dalam rumah tangga gitu ya, tapi dan mungkin lain-lain gitu ya yang bisa digunakan sebagai satu operasionalisasi hukum terhadap persoalan kekerasan seksual. Nah, tapi yang paling penting lagi adalah para korban ini rata-rata kesulitan melakukan upaya hukum. Dia secara sosial kadang sudah tertekan gitu, tidak berani ngomong, nggak tahu harus bicara sama siapa. Kalaupun membuat pengaduan itu kadang tidak selalu langsung direspon atau mungkin dia juga tidak punya media komunikasi yang baik gitu. Nah, ini menurut saya tantangan yang itu tidak harus menunggu undang-undang ini jadi, tapi upaya-upaya untuk melindungi korban itu bisa dilakukan dengan banyak cara gitu. Entah dari community gitu ya, atau dari pemerintahan daerah, pemerintahan desa. Nah, menurut saya kesadaran-kesadaran ini dengan makin meningkatnya kekerasan akibat pandemi, nah ini harus segera dilakukan upaya yang lebih praktikal gitu, yang lebih ada implementasinya, sambil kemudian kita memang tetap membahas atau memperjuangkan RU penghapusan kekerasan seksual ini diloloskan di dalam DPR. Itu saya jadi terpikir, mungkin nanti kita dengan Kementerian Pemberdayaan Perempuan di DPR kita bahas juga ya Bu Fene ya, bagaimana upaya-upaya yang in between atau dalam proses undang-undang ini berjalan kita bisa jalankan gitu. Terima kasih, Mbak.
Ya. Oke, masih bisa Bapak moderator saya tambahkan supaya tidak lupa karena ini pertanyaan ini krusial sekali. Right. So as you know that we have already at the sub-district, district level and the provincial level what we call that this is from the one that unit pelayanan terpadu pemberdayaan dan perlindungan perempuan dan anak. Nah, ini this is the unit pelayanan integrated unit services for the protection of women and children. So they are the one that is very active, you know, to see in their area whether there is a crime or this against women or there is a violence against women or sexual harassment and stuff like that. So they are the one that doing the pendampingan dan shelter. Jadi Ibu Enda ada UPT PPPA yang ada di daerah. Nah, ini nanti akan pendampingan baik segi hukum, baik segi shelter, keamanan, dan lain sebagainya. Begitu juga di polisi sebenarnya ada UPPA, Unit Perlindungan Perempuan dan Anak, yang dikelola biasanya oleh polisi-polisi perempuan. Itu pertama. Lalu kedua, di dalam hal ini juga kami telah melakukan training to the APH, aparat penegak hukum, so the law enforcer. We did the training for, we are doing the training for, and then we have done the training to the law enforcers, such as police, judge, and then hakim ya, and then prosecutor and judge, and also for the pendamping dalam hal ini. So they have the perspective gender, they do have the perspective gender, so that it will influence their decision making in, you know, in tackling the gender based violence, yeah, stuff like that. I think.
Thank you, Ibu Fene. So basically, all kinds of supports needed till the bill has finally passed in the Indonesian Parliament. And the support such as medical care, counseling, legal assistance, and also community awareness programs are very crucial to help these victims of GBV. And also I have this interesting questions coming from...
Moderator, sebelum lupa lagi, ada satu. Jadi kita punya line, SAPA namanya, Sahabat Perempuan dan Anak. We have hotline 129. Ya,
129,
and then that's SAPA, Sahabat Perempuan Anak, the Friend of Women and Children. Okay, that's 24 hours. If there's something happen, you know, you can call that line. And also we have the psychological services one day 24 hours, which is Sejiwa. Okay, Sejiwa is 118 extension 8. Okay, 119 extension 8. Yeah, I'll check it again, but. There's two lines that's very important, yeah. Nowadays, because COVID restrict people to go outside, and sometimes they hesitate to report. Okay, they hesitate, and even, you know, maybe the system online, you know, reporting online, they don't know how to do to operate that one, and the infrastructure like the availability of gadget and things like that, you know. So we have the hotline. Okay.
Thank you, Ibu Fena. So Ibu Fena just added that in Indonesia, we also have 24-hour hotlines for all the victims of GBV. You can call in 129. So if you have any reports on these cases, don't worry. You can just contact them and they will help you with anything you need. And also for the psychological assistance, you can also call 119 extension 8, Ibu Fena. So you can get the help that you need. And also I have this interesting questions coming from Latif. His name is Dika, majoring in law of President University. His question is for Chai. Chai, both Indonesia and the US are democratic countries. Both also have diversity of people. What are the main challenges in the public policy signing?
Yeah, that's a really great question, and one that I think connects U.S. to Indonesia is we have so many different communities that represent and are represented in our federal government and in the national government. I think it's fairly challenging to come to consensus on a variety of different issues that are complex and that have historically been dealt with in a community level or in a kind of a regional level. So I think one of the primary things that I go back to in this work is focusing on coalition building, focusing on where there are similarities. And I think every single person wants to make sure that everyone is safe, right? Nobody is going to be pro-violence for, you know, indiscriminate towards women, girls, boys, and men. But I think that if we come to that consensus saying, you know, we all want to reduce and we all want to end intimate partner violence, domestic violence, sexual violence, child marriage, I think that there are ways that we can do this, and particularly when survivors are in that conversation and are leading those conversations, it makes it much harder to say no to those issues because you have a survivor who is speaking up and sharing her experiences and trying to tell the public how they can make sure that the systems are built better to address the needs that she needed to get out of an abusive relationship or, you know, to end the sexual harassment that she was facing at work. So I think, you know, it is very hard to find consensus and it takes a lot of time. Mm-hmm. But if you do it, there are, I think, many positive things that come out of it. Especially if you do it with survivors, women and girls at the center of those discussions and leading the discussion.
Thank you, Chai. So, sebenarnya menurut Chai sendiri tidak akan ada orang yang pro sama yang namanya kekerasan. Jadi konsensus untuk berkomitmen mengurangi kekerasan sendiri memang dibutuhkan. Dan ini tidak dalam waktu yang singkat seperti Undang-Undang RUU PKS di Indonesia sendiri tahun ini memang belum kemudian dilegalkan, tapi tahun depan Ibu Dia dari Komisi 8 juga mengatakan bahwa undang-undang ini masuk dalam list yang akan diperjuangkan ya Ibu ya, untuk kemudian bisa menjadi undang-undang di tahun 2021. And next questions we have from Dwi from President University majoring in law. I'd like to ask these questions to the panelists. I think it's for Ibu Fena and juga Ibu Dia. Based on your perspectives, which articles or points in the RUU PKS or the highly anticipated as sexual violence in Indonesia that are the most controversial to Indonesian people, so it slows down the process to sign it.
Apa yang menyebabkan bagian mana dalam artikel undang-undang itu yang menyebabkan ini belum dilegalkan tahun ini? Ibu Fene duluan mungkin?
Actually, you know, at the first time when we do the daftar inventaris masala, which is the problem inventory list, when the legislative sent us this bill, yeah, this draft of this bill, so we as a executive, you know, reply it by doing the DIM, yeah, daftar inventaris masala, so this is a problem inventory list. So we do that, and then there's some of it that become controversial because, for example, all the pasal, yeah, the number of the pasal of the 500, how many, yeah, that's on Budia, yeah. Ada banyak, yeah, hundreds, and it become only 50, yeah, that's one. And then the second one about the definition, and the definition, so we have to work about the definition, what is the sexual violence or sexual harassment or whatever, something like that. That's the one that create a lot of problem. There's you know, a controversy, and then some. So that's why we were doing the focus group discussion with the expert, with the lawmaker, and then yeah, to solve about this. And then we come out now the new one, which is the draft new one, but hopefully we can work together again with Budia Pitaloka. We do the focus group discussion, so many, and then so a lot of expert in dealing with this one. So this one now become the real pidana, yeah, criminal law, which not doing the directly saying stated, you know, literally like the definition of the sexual is blah 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 blah, no, but directly, which is who is doing this, the punishment is this, okay, so based on the cases. So that's why it's not going to be controversial again. So it's not going to be, because for the first one, the definition saying like definition of sexual harassment or sexual violence, blah, 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 blah. And then it is 9 types of the definition. But it's, instead of doing that, we directly do what we call delictor qualification. Okay. Delictor qualification. How do you say it in English? Delictor qualification. This is qualification of the criminal, criminal perbuatan kriminalnya, jadi delik langsung, ya, langsung, it's directly who is doing that, barang siapa melakukan apa, kena ganjaran apa, jadi lakukan kekerasan seksual langsung barang siapa memegang begini akan dikenakan ini, jadi tanpa letter luck lagi definisinya tidak bilang lagi bahwa kekerasan seksual adalah merupakan ini, tidak lagi. Jadi dengan begitu kita akan mendapatkan persamaan persepsi. Saya pikir soalnya kalau kita membuat definisi secara letter luck, dari situlah orang mulai menginterpretasi macam-macam. Tapi kita susun saja suatu draft undang-undang yang memenuhi, menjawab semua kasus yang real, ya kan? Yang real, yang selama ini kita hadapi. Apa saja kasus-kasusnya. Dan itu kita susun dalam passage, dalam bentuk pasal-pasal perundang-undangan. Jadi itu namanya kita susun berdasarkan delik-delik terkualifikasi untuk hukum pidana. Untuk hukum pidana murni. Jadi dengan begitu kita tidak membilang lagi dan tidak akan lagi ada kecurigaan bahwa kita memproteksi LGBT and blah 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 and stuff like that. No. This is simply the law that law regarding or related to criminal. Criminal in on doing the sexual harassment and doing the sexual violence.
Baik, Ibu Dia, mungkin ini bisa ditambahkan? Perpetrator.
But it's not only the punishment, but you know, to rehabilitate the perpetrator in terms of maybe, you know, he has something, you know, something related to the brain. How about to do it again and again and again like that? Maybe, you know, they have dilakukan rehabilitasi as well. Okay, hal-hal seperti itu. Jadi banyak hal nanti yang akan terjadi perubahan dibandingkan dengan yang 2016, ya Budi, ya. 2015-2016, dan ini yang kami harapkan kiranya yang penting DPR itu tahun 2021 baik itu di Komisi 3 maupun di Balek, yang penting itu jalan di prolegnasnya dan tentu kita akan bekerja bersama-sama. Siapa saja bisa dengan Komisi 8, minta maaf Bu Dia, Komisi 8 ataupun dengan Balek, soalnya ini mengenai loh, jadi saya selalu berpikir Komisi 3, tapi sebenarnya kerja kami adalah dengan Komisi 8. Dengan Bu Dia ini adalah salah satu pejuang untuk undang-undang RUU PKS ini ya. Mudah-mudahan kita di 2021 bisa goal ya Bu Dia. Nanti kita pakai target. Kalau gimana kalau 2021 sampai 6 bulan belum, gimana coba? Apa yang harus kami lakukan nanti kita diskusi lagi.
Budia, baik Ibu Fene, ya. Kemudian Ibu Dia mungkin ada yang perlu ditambahkan kembali?
Ya, saya yakin ini masuk karena dorongan untuk membahasnya di DPR udah cukup kuat juga, lebih kuat dari sebelumnya. Dan saya berharap memang pembahasannya lebih rasional ya. Artinya problematika hukum ini kan memang bagus kalau bisa masuk pansus memang. Karena selain menyangkut Komisi 8, ini kan seolah dianggap hanya persoalan perempuan ya. Tapi ini kan sebetulnya persoalan perlindungan warga negara, persoalan kriminal yang menyangkut banyak sekali problematika hukum dalam kita untuk menjadikan ini undang-undang. Nah, saya makin mendalami, makin melihat bahwa ini undang-undang yang cukup kompleks ya, tidak hanya dari paradigma sosial budaya, agama, tapi juga dari konstruksi hukum kita sendiri. Ini bisa membawa satu paradigma baru terhadap hukum kita yang selama ini melihat tindak kekerasan lebih dalam kerangka kesusilaan gitu, tapi tidak dalam konstruksi di KUHP ya, tidak dalam konstruksi hak warga negara gitu untuk mendapatkan perlindungan. Nah, tidak dalam konstruksi criminal justice yang tadi Bu Fene bilang, itu menarik sekali. Jadi pembahasannya kalau menurut saya hitungannya akan lebih banyak mengeksplor antara hukum dengan konteks sosial budaya masyarakat kita yang mungkin juga hari ini kesadarannya, problematikanya berubah. Nah, poin-poin yang menjadi sejauh ini pembahasan yang cukup menarik, yang menjadi cukup banyak melahirkan debat di DPR, itu pertama ya itu tadi saya sudah sampaikan, Bu Fene juga sudah sampaikan, mengenai definisi kekerasan seksual. Kalau bahasa Inggris mungkin lebih enak sexual violence gitu ya, dia kenal konstruksi violence. Violence itu orang langsung dapat maknanya gitu, kekerasan seksual, sexual violence. Tapi kalau dalam bahasa Indonesia, kekerasan itu punya arti yang lebih luas daripada sekedar violence. Nah, ini yang sejauh ini banyak kemudian kekerasan tuh maksudnya di sini apa gitu loh. Kita harus menjelaskan yang lebih, walaupun orang paham kekerasan seksual ketika diartikan itu mengikuti seksual, itu berarti kekerasan seksual, sexual violence yang diadopsi dari sexual violence. Tapi ketika itu diterjemahkan kekerasan itu bisa jadi tingkat kekerasan sebuah benda gitu ya dan lain-lain. Nah, ini yang ini kadang secara diksi juga dibahas di DPR. Nah, pertama tentu definisi dan diksi. Yang kedua ada kayak misalnya pelecehan seksual. Nah, ini banyak sekali yang keberatan dengan persoalan pembuktian dalam definisi pelecehan seksual. Bagaimana membuktikan sesuatu yang kadang intangible. Nah, ini juga yang sejauh ini banyak menimbulkan pertanyaan di DPR. Lalu juga pemaksaan perkawinan misalnya, ini juga bagaimana mendefinisikan atau memastikan bahwa dia dipaksa atau tidak gitu. Walaupun kita paham dalam konteks yang terjadi, seringkali terjadi pemaksaan perkawinan, tapi agak sulit menjawab bagaimana menginterpretasikan bahwa perkawinan itu berupa paksaan. Kalau misalnya kedua calon mempelainya itu setuju, padahal kan bisa jadi di balik persetujuannya itu ada tekanan gitu ya dari keluarga dan lain-lain atau dikondisikan. Nah, ini juga persoalan-persoalan konteks sosial atau konteks budaya yang memang tidak mudah untuk tidak sederhana gitu. Dia harus punya poin-poin yang bisa memahami latar belakang dari definisi-definisi itu. Nah, selain itu ya interpretasi agama bahwa tidak mungkinlah kalau misalnya dalam perkawinan, walaupun sudah ada undang-undang KDRT, penghapusan kekerasan dalam rumah tangga, tapi bahasanya bagaimana kalau istri kita menuntut kita. Nah, ini kembali lagi mungkin saya rasa ya, perdebatannya seperti pada saat perdebatan undang-undang penghapusan kekerasan dalam rumah tangga gitu. Ada perspektif agama yang mengatakan bahwa perspektif agama yang dipegang seseorang yang mengatakan bahwa gak boleh istri misalnya menuntut suami apabila suami ingin melakukan hubungan seksual dengan istri, dan kalau istri menolak dan melakukan kekerasan itu sudah kewajibannya. Nah, hal-hal kayak gini yang kadang butuh waktu lah, tapi saya yakin saya bagaimana sebetulnya kalau saya pembuat undang-undang tuh lebih memikirkan bagaimana solusi-solusi draftingnya gitu untuk menjawab persoalan-persoalan yang menyangkut draft, diksi, interpretasi gitu ya, atau bagaimana harmonisasi dengan berbagai undang-undang yang ada, bagaimana mengantarkan paradigma yang hari ini menjadi tantangan dari konteks kekerasan-kekerasan yang ada, supaya kita punya persamaan paradigma. Nah, tapi syukur hari ini di DPR rata-rata sudah sepakat bahwa kekerasan seksual ini satu hal yang buruk. Nah, itu yang saya anggap satu progres, satu kemajuan. Dan yang kedua, tinggal tantangannya adalah di dalam problematika drafting, ya, karena banyak persoalan itu tadi ya, kata-kata dan konteks sosial dan lain-lain, itu yang menurut saya cukup menantang dalam pembahasannya nanti. Tapi animo di DPR, animo fraksi-fraksi banyak, semakin banyak yang mendukung untuk disahkannya RUU penghapusan kekerasan seksual ini.
Baik, Ibu Dia. So Ibu Dia is optimistic that the highly anticipated sexual violence bill or RUU penghapusan kekerasan perempuan will be accepted by the parliament after discussions in next year national legislation program. Hopefully that it can be accepted, ya Ibu ya. And also because we only have a few minutes left, I will read the last questions for all the panelists. This is coming from Gabriela from President University, majoring in international relations. She sent her questions to @America Instagram. She asked, do you think that the higher percentage of women in politics or parliaments will relate to the higher chance of policies focused on women? Maybe for each panelist, I give you 1 minute to answer these questions. Dari Ibu Pene.
Sorry, ulang lagi soalnya agak begini, coba ulang lagi.
Do you think that the higher percentage of women in politics or parliaments will relate to the higher chance of policies focused on women? Jadi kalau misalnya lebih banyak perempuan yang ada di parlemen itu, apakah akan menjamin bahwa akan lebih banyak policies atau kebijakan yang berpihak pada perempuan, Ibu?
Ya, tentu saya berharap. I hope so, but let's see. I'm going to ask Ibu Dia Pitaloka, your peers, ya, teman-temanmu di parlemen, apakah betul seperti itu? Is your friends are your friends in the parliament like that, or maybe they are the one that it's not sisterhood? Okay, it's like sisterhood, you know, it's not working there. And then, in order to pass the bill regarding the protection of or the protection of women and children, of yeah. Saya berharap begitu, saya berharap sekali, karena konstruksi sosial kita kan patriarkal. Memang ada beberapa tempat yang matriarkal, tapi rata-rata patriarkal. Mudah-mudahan dengan representasi dari perempuan di DPR maupun di DPD akan memberikan perubahan yang besar.
Ya. Ibu Dia?
Ya, kalau saya lebih tertarik bagaimana kita memastikannya, artinya perjuangan perempuan dalam politik ketika dia mendapatkan tempat, mendapatkan kursi di parlemen, nah dia selanjutnya punya perjuangan berikutnya bagaimana kursi itu bisa membawa keadilan yang lebih baik bagi perempuan gitu loh. Nah ini jadi ada perjuangan berikutnya menurut saya, bagaimana itu tadi Bu Vene bilang membangun sisterhood. Tapi sejauh pengalaman saya bersama anggota parlemen perempuan, mereka rata-rata lebih gampang, lebih paham karena pengalamannya sebagai perempuan. Jadi kalau kita bicara menjelaskan misalnya pelecehan seksual, nggak banyak laki-laki, mungkin tidak sebanyak perempuan yang mengalami pelecehan seksual. Tapi kalau perempuan langsung nangkep, iya saya juga sebel deh katanya. Ya kan? Ini jadi ada pengalaman yang memang spesifik dari perempuan yang tidak dialami mungkin oleh kebanyakan laki-laki gitu, sehingga sensitivitas, gender sensitivity-nya tentu lebih baik. Nah, tinggal bagaimana kita membangun atau mengorganize. Makanya saya berharap kaukus ini bisa sangat membantu ya bagi perjuangan isu-isu perempuan di dalam, dan kita juga pastinya butuh support dari teman-teman yang concern sama persoalan perempuan dari publik gitu ya, untuk memperkuat argumentasi. Bahwa saya kaget juga tadi kata Mbak Chai ya, Chai Shenoy, bahwa ternyata problematika sexual violence ini masih ada di seluruh belahan dunia, baik negara maju ataupun negara yang belum maju gitu. Nah ini tentunya kita ini seperti membangunkan kesadaran, this is our problem gitu loh in the world. Nah, ini juga bukan hanya persoalan perempuan yang memperjuangkan haknya, tapi juga persoalan laki-laki yang ingin mewujudkan sebuah dunia yang lebih adil. Dan itu menurut saya persoalan perjuangan kekerasan seksual ini, penghapusan kekerasan seksual ini, itu sangat mengakar gitu ya bagi perjuangan bagaimana kita mewujudkan masyarakat yang demokratik tanpa poin emansipasi di dalamnya. Jadi ini sebetulnya persoalan kita semua, dunia yang penuh kekerasan itu bukan hanya persoalan perempuan, tapi ini persoalan dunia gitu. Kita tentunya ingin dunia yang tidak penuh dengan kekerasan gitu. Dan tadi kembali kepada pertanyaan bagaimana apakah kursi perempuan itu mengantarkan perjuangan yang lebih terhadap keadilan untuk perempuan, saya related ya, saya lebih percaya atau saya lebih banyak menemukan perempuan yang lebih paham persoalan perempuan gitu daripada anggota laki-laki gitu. Terima kasih.
Okay, Shane, what do you think about that questions?
Yeah, I think it's a really great question. And I think, you know, both of the speakers have already mentioned what I was going to say. I think the only thing that I'll add is that we have in the U.S. our president signed the Women, Peace, and Security Act, which is underpinned by this theory that if women are involved in peace and security and politics, they're represented in the government, they will have, you know, a stronger likelihood that the peace will be stronger and will last for longer, and that women's issues will be brought to the fold. And one of those issues that's included in the act is gender-based violence. So I do think that there's a lot that women can bring to the table. I think, but the most important thing is representation and seeing women in politics, seeing women in business, seeing women in educational institutions are all very, very important for young girls and young boys to see that women can do anything that they want and that they strive to do. So, you know, I think more than anything, it's not that, you know, necessarily that if women are in politics, then all of a sudden women's issues will be resolved. It's more that that there'll be more diverse voices at the table to bring up all of these issues, which mm-hmm. will then strengthen any law and any outcome that the nation is seeking.
Jadi tidak semata-mata menjamin bahwa dengan adanya perwakilan perempuan di parlemen itu akan menjamin bahwa lebih banyak kebijakan yang akan berpihak pada perempuan, tetapi akan lebih banyak suara-suara yang menyuarakan berbagai macam masalah, tidak hanya dari perspektif perempuan atau laki-laki saja. Okay, from this discussion, we learned that gender-based violence is deeply rooted in societal norms, but it's also interlinked
with some other factors such as economy, law and regulations, education, and also culture. As a part of a community, we are all responsible for this situation, not only the policymakers and the victims themselves. Before I close this important discussion, we will watch the US Aid Bersama video.
Saya Alcia Alfrida Makanwai, saya perawat di Puskesmas Tanjung Ria. Saya ibu dari dua orang anak. Setiap ibu atau setiap orang tua tentunya mempunyai harapan yang sangat luar biasa terhadap anak-anaknya, sama seperti saya. Pendapat saya, kekerasan berbasis gender masih tinggi di Indonesia maupun di Papua. Yang pertama karena pengetahuan masyarakat itu sendiri terkait dengan kekerasan. Ada beberapa budaya yang menghalalkan itu, seperti kami orang Papua, ketika sudah dibayar mas kawin, laki-laki berhak sepenuhnya terhadap perempuan tersebut. Padahal secara aturan hukum, itu tidak dibolehkan. Nah, ini terkait juga dengan pengetahuan, kemudian budaya, lalu sosial di masyarakat. Bagaimana informasi ini tidak terserap secara menyeluruh sampai ke masyarakat yang di level bawah. Sehingga kekerasan berbasis gender ini masih tetap terjadi. Saya sudah bertugas kurang lebih 14 tahun di Puskesmas Tanjung Ria. Saya untuk terkait pelayanan kekerasan berbasis gender bertugas sebagai konselor. Setiap tahunnya rata-rata pasien kekerasan berbasis gender 12 sampai dengan 15 korban kekerasan yang datang ke layanan Puskesmas Tanjung Ria. Di luar dari itu pasti tentunya banyak, mungkin ada yang langsung ke rumah sakit, ke polsek. Dengan USAID bersama juga kami bersama-sama menyusun SOP penanganan korban kekerasan berbasis gender. Yang pertama, SOP itu disusun untuk memudahkan siapapun itu petugasnya. Jadi tidak hanya saya, tetapi teman yang lain pun akan melakukan sesuai dengan standar yang sudah baku yang ada di dalam puskesmas.
Perubahan yang terjadi ketika kehadiran USAID bersama kami di pusat pelayanan terpadu itu, kami didorong, kami dibantu untuk kerja berdasarkan standar operasional prosedur yang ada. Yang kalau sebelumnya ya agak susah ya, karena kesehatan kerja sendiri, kepolisian kerja sendiri, kami di P2 TP2 kerja sendiri seperti itu. Tetapi setelah ada pendampingan dengan SOP yang dilakukan oleh USAID bersama, koordinasi ini semakin lancar.
Harapan saya untuk kedua anak saya ke depan, mereka bisa menjadi agen perubahan, khususnya kekerasan berbasis gender. Mereka bisa bersuara, bisa menyuarakan bahwa kekerasan berbasis gender itu tidak dibenarkan baik secara hukum maupun agama manapun. Kemudian mereka bisa mensosialisasi ke teman-temannya atau ke siapa saja, tidak hanya di Kota Jayapura, Papua maupun Indonesia dan dunia.
That's it for today, guys. Thank you to our moderator and also all of our great speakers for sharing the great session today with Ad America TV. Back again with me, Fifi. If you guys still remember that earlier in the event, I asked you guys a question. And the question is, when did the United States Congress pass the Violence Against Women Act? And the correct answer is B, 1994. Congratulations to Lulu F. Pasha from Facebook for answering correctly. And thank you to all of you for your participation. And now you guys might be wondering, how can you develop an idea for a place like this? It's very easy and simple. Just go to our website at www.atamerica.or.id. Go to collaborate with us and choose create an event. All event proposals coming to us will be reviewed and your event might be featured here soon. And also, don't forget to subscribe to our weekly newsletter at our website for more infos and updates about Ad America. And one more thing, don't forget to follow all of our social media accounts. We're on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at AT America. And subscribe to our YouTube channel at AT America. Thank you for tuning in with us tonight, and thank you for your participation. I hope to see you again in the next Ad America TV. Bye, everyone.